Fun. This should be thrilling. A video in how long? It's been a while since we have one, but I think it's actually about time we reintroduced ourselves. Maybe. Anyway, hi, I'm Abigail, and I know a good amount of you. There are a lot of you that are new. Okay, the point of this. Right. Recently, someone posted something about voices. And the point of this video is there really is no set system, I guess you could say, to having the voice you want. It is a matter of work. And the work takes time. It just doesn't come like, you know, ooh, I got it. It's like practice. You have vocal muscles. For example, if you're an MTF, you have vocal muscles which have been used to being lazy for all that time, and you have not had to work them out one iota, not once. So now all of a sudden you go, oh my god, I've got to do this. I've got to get on there. I've got to sound like, and no, it's doesn't happen. Sorry. You have to take time. You have to push your pitch up. You have to practice your resonance, your pronunciation. I mean, there are just so many things. And they don't happen naturally. Right, okay, I can see I'm going around in circles. But, the point really is, it's a matter of practice and hormones. That is the other part of this equation. Now, you know, along the cusp, the voices sound very similar. And oftentimes indistinguishable. Borderline voices, for example, like Cher and Tim Gunn, can actually cross over. Aside from a few of the clues, you most of the time wouldn't know, per se, but that's another story. So, right. This crossing over involves a number of things, but one is your pitch. Okay, now I'm going to try to put this into a way that makes sense. One, you have to take this, and yes, I know I still have mine there, and push it up and start getting it to levitate. It is not easy at first. And honestly speaking, when you first start exercising it, you may actually, for MTFs at least, you may actually have to hold your finger there and move it up. Because it won't do it itself at first. Second, most people, if you put your finger, you'll feel your voice comes from down here. It's actually vibrates. You're not only moving that up, but you're moving your voice projection. And this is going to sound weird, but you're moving it up in this direction. But at the same time, you're moving the source for your volume, which is usually also from the same area. See, the fact that you're, oh god, there's a good way to put this. Right, okay, the fact that your voice is, your vocal folds are widened. And your vocal muscles are out here. means you actually have no reason to seek a power source. So you can basically get your volume from right here in your chest, which is why it vibrates so much on men. When you basically fix this, though, now you can get your... Basically, you can get into diaphragm breathing, which is exactly how you can actually vocalize like this without missing one beat and actually continue on without stopping or pausing or even gasping for breath most of the time. But this is a practice that takes time, and it doesn't come overnight. Hormones have a lot to do with it, believe it or not. In the case of FTMs, they help expand the muscle and expand the focal folds. These create a deeper, richer recognition. I am getting marble-mouthed. They help create a deeper, richer resonance that then can be used for volume and projection. So you really don't need the crystal clarity of pronunciation and enunciation that you would otherwise. Now, it should be mentioned that in the opposite, there is actually an effect. And transmen, I'm not sure if all of them notice this with testosterone. But then again, they work out their focal muscles, so they also come into it with a different texture. Okay, but with trans women, basically, when you're taking the hormones, they're affecting the tissue, the muscle, the skin you generate. So now, the voice that you had before is actually smoother. And you can hear this as time goes on, with or without exercising your voice. And this has an effect of making a smoother, clearer sounding voice. I know, it sounds weird. I'm trying to think of how to describe it. But if you're a trans woman who's actually been listening to how your voice changed on hormones, which it does slightly, you'll know what I mean. All of a sudden, there's a refinement to it. It's sort of like, it's like your breathing changes as well, even without practice. And then when you actually practice, your breathing changes even more. So there is a lot to it. And I think in some ways, it also changes your hearing. But maybe that's just me. I'm moderately to severely hearing impaired, so I have a lot of challenge in that area, and, you know, I'm more sensitive to the changes in that respect. So, but, in as far as men, most of the changes can occur via hormones, which is rather easygoing and doesn't require a lot of concentration. It is for trans women where we've gotten used to actually using, or not so much using, our focal muscles, that this actually changes a lot, and it basically it basically causes us to have to exercise those vocal cords in a way we hadn't before. And that need to exercise them, it is our greatest problem. But when we exercise them, and when we go out, and when we socialize, and when we finally exercise our voice fearlessly in public, which is the big obstacle, is when we start to get natural. And that's most of all when, with the other cues on the phone or in person, that we start getting called ma'am most often. I think that's it, actually. So, you know, the voice, feminine voices are difficult. And there should be a distinction here between what is actually feminine and what is stereotypically feminine, because they are two different things. Stereotypically could be something like Lily Tomlin. But non-stereotypically, you have Bette Midler, in doing this, especially in states in New York, like New York, where trans health care is completely covered. It only makes sense in my books. All right, then. Nice talking to you.